Ladies and gentlemen, His Excellency the President of India, Dr. Kalam.
Good afternoon to all of you. Friends, I was hearing honorable dignitaries who are paying the tributes to Dhirubhai Ambani ji. I was thinking myself, if we have been alive, if honorable dignitaries just stated all this what they said today, what he will do? What he will do, I was thinking myself. Then I felt he will smile. So really he deserves what all our friends have told. Now, my title of this Dhirubhai Ambani Memorial Lecture is Growth is Life. Growth is life. That is the title I have given. I am happy to be present here to deliver to the first Sri Dhirubhai Ambani Memorial Lecture. At the outset, my prayers to the Ambani family on this day. And best wishes to all the members assembled here, particularly entrepreneurs. For me, Sri Dhirubhai Ambani represented a strong mind which propagated that having small aim is a crime. I will repeat it. Sri Dhirubhai Ambani represented a strong mind which propagated that having a small aim is a crime. His actions gave courage to the small entrepreneurs to think big and work towards it. His legacy will be always remembered to having imparted hope to the budding entrepreneurs and instilled courage in them to take risks and face all odds bravely to accomplish these goals. Having successfully created a following of over 33 lakh shareholders, he demonstrated how even first-time entrepreneurs, by their determined efforts and commitment to their dreams, can grow from strength to strength to become a major player in market economy. In recalling what Srimati Ambani told her son when the news was broken to her about the passing away of her husband would be one of the best tributes that one can pay to him, and I quote her, quote, "Your father has gone to heaven. That is a permanent home. God sent him to earth on a mission. He chose India and he chose the family. Now there are others to carry on this mission here, so God needs him back to heaven to do his work," unquote. Her message is clear. Her message is clear. Mission makes the man. Friends, after Anil talked to me that I have to speak on the first Ambani Memorial Lecture, I took it seriously. I studied a lot of books about him. I went through the internet. I did all sorts of things. Finally, I locked onto a book, a beautiful book. I love that book. That is written about 2,000 years back by Thiruvalluvar, And he has composed 1,330 chorals, couplets, for how to live a good life, how to live a beautiful life, without thinking which country you belong, without thinking which religion you belong, without thinking which language you belong, without thinking which caste you belong. And 2,000 years back, he composed this 1,330 Tamil couplets. I have taken two to represent the indomitable spirit of a man. Wherever there is indomitable spirit of man, the man succeeds, the woman succeeds, the village succeeds, the state succeeds, the country succeeds, the world succeeds. The indomitable spirit. Sri Dhirubhai Ambani has a mission and a great entrepreneur who had seen successes. For success, any mission, what we need is indomitable spirit. Let us study the characteristics of an indomitable spirit. It has two components. Indomitable spirit has got two components. The first component is that there must be a vision leading to higher goals of achievement. I would like to recall a couplet, the Thirukkural, by the poet Saint Thiruvalluvar, written in 2000 years ago. I will tell it in Tamil because I am accustomed to it, and then I will translate it. Vellathanaya malanitam mandardam ullathanayadu uyarvu. It's a two sentences. It means that whatever may be the depth of the river or lake or pond, whatever they may be the conditions of the water, the lily flower always comes out of the and blossoms. Similarly, if there is a definite determination to achieve a goal, even if it is impossible to achieve, the man succeeds. This is one of the component of the indomitable spirit. This is applicable to Dhirubhai Ambani ji. The second one, that many of us have gone through large programs and projects. We would have experienced the success is not in sight, and there are many hurdles. Hurdles created by man, hurdle created by the nature of the program, hurdle created by the technology, all this impossible in a major program like what wealth generation. The same poet reminds us at this point of time through another couplet, Idumbaikki Idumbai Padupar, Idumbaikki Idumbai Padadavar. It means that successful leaders can never be defeated by problems. They become the master of the situation and they defeat the problems. Now friends, the indomitable spirit is defined by these two conditions. I consider these two Thirukkurals, characteristics, characterize the indomitable spirit of Dhirubhai Ambani. Whenever he encountered problems, he gave the problems to the problems. He inhibited the indomitable spirit in successfully implementing the complex missions. Now, friends, I have selected the topic for the memorial lecture in tribute to Sri Dhirubhai Ambani, Growth is Life. Now, you know, in India, we are still a developing country from 1947 onwards. The developed country means you are not economically strong, you are not respected as a 1 billion people of population, and also you are 260 million people are below poverty line. So the essence of a developed nation is to bring that 260 million people above the poverty line to a good life, and also to have the people in there, 1 billion people, people of civilization, great civilization, they should have a standing in this planet. How do you do that? A team of scientists, two groups worked, one in the Planning Commission, another TIFAC, Technology Information Forecasting Council. These two groups, one worked on the technology and another worked on the good life. They combined these two reports, two types of reports, about 50 volumes, and they called India Millennium Mission 2020. And they identified 5 areas of importance, simultaneously progress to make the nation developed. The first area is the agriculture and food processing. They didn't say agriculture, they said food processing, so that you can do the value addition. The second area is education and healthcare, again the coupled. The third area is communication and information technology that will lead to telemedicine, tele-education, and more wanted e-governance. Then fourth area is the infrastructure development. There the stress is water. Water is going to create problem between states in our country. Water is going to create a problem between country to country. So water is a dominating force. Fortunately, we have decided to form a task team for river networking. River networking. That means these basins of surplus water should be connected to the basin of a deficit water. This is the fourth area. The fifth area, self-reliance and critical technology. These are the 5 areas have been identified. Now the question is, since there are so many entrepreneurs here, particularly young entrepreneurs, I have repeated a number of times, I don't mind repeating that one incident. That incident for me is a university education. I have not read anywhere. I have gone around the orbit 71 times around the sun. I have not gone through any education, such a beautiful education I got in 1979-1980 period, I thought of sharing with you on this occasion, Dhirubhai Ambani Memorial Lecture. It is like this, 1979, August 17th, we were ready for launch of a satellite launch vehicle with 44 subsystems and thousands of components. It was built in Vikram Sarabhai Space Center, and at that time, Professor Satish Dhawan was the chairman of Atomic Energy Space Commission, and he is also Space Center. And he gave me the task in 1973 to build a satellite launch vehicle, to put a satellite in the orbit. 1973, he gave me this task. In 79, we were ready. Thousands of engineers, 10,000 of workers and staff, they all worked together. Then we moved the satellite launch vehicle from Vikram Sarabhai Space Center to the now Satish Dhawan Space Center at Sriharikota. So the launch vehicle was in the launch pad, and the day 17th August 1979, and I am the mission director, project director, and we are all in the control center, and computer takes over. T-minus 8 minutes, computer will take over, because very difficult for me as a mission director to check hundreds of parameters. So it has to be checked. Computer, we hand over the whole launch of the rocket system to the computer. So when T-minus 8 minutes came, I handed over to the computer for the launch on 17th August 1979. And thousands of people are waiting for the launch mission centers, and they are working throughout the country and some downrange stations. Exactly at T-minus 8 minutes, computer took over. And then at T-minus 4 minutes, computer put a hold. It says, don't launch. So we are all, because at that time, the whole rocket system is alive, and every explosive system, propellant system, electronic system, all are on, ready to launch. Computer says, don't launch. At T-minus 4 minutes, then immediately a computer printout comes out. There is some problem in the second stage control system. There's a leakage, so you don't launch. Behind me, there are number of experts, 6-7 experts, my expert 10 years, 20 years experienced people. I turn to them, and they are in their computers to find out what happened, and they tell me within a minute, they say there's a problem in the second stage control system, and we cannot launch, computer says, but we believe as experts, the ignite, that is oxidizer, sufficiently more there, even though there's a leakage in the system, you can launch. They asked me to launch. That is, I can say to the computer, to shut off the computer, I can manually launch the rocket system. I discussed with my experts, I believed in them, I agreed with them, I'm responsible for it. I immediately put the rocket in the manual mode. So rocket took off, 100 seconds, beautiful launch, and the rocket first stage did its job. It's a four-stage rocket system. Then the second stage took off. Within a minute, within a second, it got into spin. That means it should be steady. It's a controlled rocket system by a guidance system. But it was going to the spin. I knew I lost the rocket system. Within few seconds, instead of putting the satellite in the orbit, the whole system went to Bay of Bengal. So it was a failure. And then how do you handle a failure? It's very important for entrepreneurs. Life is not so simple. We have to handle the failures with stout heart. My chairman, that is the Professor Satish Dhawan, exactly at 6:30, I was very tired of continuously working. He come to my room, you join me for a press conference. On that day, press call in the morning, there's a press conference. Hundreds of press reporters, media people have assembled. Professor Dhawan told me, Satish Dhawan told me, I am going to handle the press conference, you are going to come with me. He took me there. And there was a press, the national press, international press. They asked a lot of questions. How can you put 20 crores in Bay of Bengal, one guy asked. And like that, so many serious questions. After all, people will ask questions, the people's money. So like that, number of questions were there. And Professor Satish Dhawan said, yes, it's a failure. First time we have launched, we have gained a lot of system, and definitely we will succeed. I'll give all the support my technologies. I'll give all the support to my scientists. We will succeed in a year's time, he said. Friends, did you observe what happened there? I am the mission director. I am the project director. I have failed the missions. With me, 5,000 people have worked. But chairman, Indian Space Research Organization, he took the responsibility of the failure. He completely switched my failure to his failure. This is the leadership quality. Exactly after 1 year, that is 18th July 1980, we go to the launch pad and the countdown starts. T-minus 8 minutes, I hand over to the computer. Computer checks out. First stage, it initiates the rocket system. First stage gives the required velocity. Second stage gives the required velocity. Third stage gives the required velocity. And fourth stage required the escape velocity for the put the satellite in the orbit. I am seeing in front of me how, what is the performance taking place. I took the microscope, I put the mic, I announced all the station. Here is your mission director. The satellite is in the orbit and we congratulate you, I told them. Now that's not the important, that's one of the important things happened. But after 30 minutes, Vikram Satish Dhawan called me. Go for press conference, you conduct the press conference, he said. Can you see the significance? Failure he took it, success he gave me to my team. This is a great lesson. It's a great lesson. This is a great lesson which no university taught me, no book taught me, but that one person, that institution taught me such a big lesson. So I thought of sharing with you on this day of Sri Dhirubhai Ambani Memorial Lecture. Now, you may be asking yourself, what I can do, what I will do, what I will do as an entrepreneur. So I'm addressing to entrepreneurs. You know, today, 700 million people are in our rural areas. Out of a billion people, billion plus, 700 million people are in the rural area. Unless our rural area, villages developed, the state cannot be developed, and the states if cannot develop, country cannot be developed. So how do we develop? How do you make the villages economically a strong force? Here, friends, we have worked out a scheme. Professor Indreshan and some of us joined together. It's called PURA, providing urban facilities in rural areas. So this calls for giving the four connectivities. Suppose you are in Mumbai, you go 30, 40 kilometers, 20 kilometers anywhere, or Maharashtra, any place you go from the town, city town, or Nasik, you go to Nasik, from Nasik 20, 30 kilometers you go, series of villages are there, 20, 30 villages, you'll find cluster. So the first and foremost, this PURA conveys, you generate a physical connectivity. Physical connectivity means the road and transport, the buses, you connect that one. Once you give the road, once you give the bus, suddenly you'll find the people who live in the villages, or schools approachable, hospital approachable, their farms are approachable. Then the second connectivity, you provide electronic connectivity. That is, electronic connectivity means a telephone and also the internet kiosk. Once you give the telephone, internet kiosk, and the physical connectivity, you will find telemedicine, tele-education, e-governance, e-commerce will enter in the big way in the village community. The third area we have to provide is knowledge connectivity. Knowledge connectivity, school already will be there, but you do the tele-education setup. And also vocational training. You teach the students vocational training. When he leaves the school, 10 plus 2, he will go with a certificate that he is a good maintenance engineer, or he is a good maintenance mechanic, or he is good a programmer, or in girls, good nurses, like that it will happen. So you will find the three connectivities if you give: physical connectivity, electronic connectivity, and the knowledge connectivity, then the village complex will become, have the economic connectivity. This I suggest to you, each one of you, or a group of you, your entrepreneurs can join together with the bank. There are banks who give the loan with low interest, and so you manage this for providing urban facility in the rural area, and this is one of the best opportunities in front of us, and particularly for bold entrepreneurs. Finally, friends, I would like to convey a creative leadership. What is a creative leadership? For building a developed India, what are needed? We have natural resources. We have human power, billion human power. There are 700 million people below 35 years in the population of a billion people. The nation needs young leaders who can command the change. For transformation of India into a developed nation embedded with the knowledge society from now to 2020. The leaders are the creators of new organization of excellence. Quality leaders are like magnets that will attract the best of person to build the team for the organization and give inspiring leadership even during failures of the mission, as they are not afraid of risks. I have seen and I worked with creators of vision and mission. One of the very important ingredients to success of the vision of transforming India into a developed nation by 2020 is the evolution of a creative leaders. I am giving a connectivity between developed India, economic prosperity, technology, production, productivity, employee role and management of quality, all of which link to the creative leaders. Who is that creative leader? You have to ask yourself, who is that creative leader? What are the qualities of the creative leader? The creative leadership, I am defining, the creative leadership is exercising the task to change the traditional role from commander to coach, manager to mentor, from director to the delegator, and from the one he demands respect to who facilitate the self-respect. The higher the proportion of the creative leaders in a nation, the higher the potential of success of visions that like developed India. In conclusion, reverence for life is indeed possible in real sense if a philosophical thought of reverence can be transformed into action by empowering various components of the society. When the child is empowered by the parents at various phases of growth, the child gets transformed into a responsible citizen. When a teacher is empowered with knowledge and experience, good young human beings with value system emerge. When that individual or a team is empowered with technology, transformation to higher potential for achievement is assured. When a leader or any institution empowers his or her people, leaders are born who can change the nation in multiple areas. When women are empowered, society with stability gets assured. When the political leaders of the nation empower the people through visionary policies, the prosperity of the nation is certain. When religions are empowered and become spiritual force, when the religions become a spiritual force, the peace and happiness will blossom in people's heart. Such an empowered stage will lead to creation of an enlightened citizen with value system. Here I suggested a solution by evolution of an enlightened human being with a combination of education with value system, religion graduating to spiritualism, and visionary policies for prosperity. Based on the core competence, India has experience with great qualities of leadership to manage the nation of billion people with various dimensions, every aspect of life. Now we should not allow any religion or any individual fanaticism to endanger our nation, because nation is very important compared to any individual or any party or any religion. My best wishes and greetings to all of you. God bless you.